Hey guys, welcome to a brand new video on the channel, and today I have quite an interesting video for you. With the recent release of the Google Pixel 2 and the iPhone 8, I have been hearing a lot about POLED displays as well as IPS displays. But really, what is the difference between the two, and are there any similarities? That's what I'm here to answer. So to anyone who may not know, anyone who knows very little about the two, stay tuned and let's talk. Why don't we start off with POLED? POLED is an acronym for plastic organic light emitting diode. Now, if you want to get a basic definition of the root term here, which is OLED, I would recommend that you watch my video pitting OLED and QLED displays against each other. I'll link it down below. But in short, an OLED display is basically a light emitting diode containing thin flexible sheets of organic electroluminescent materials used for visual displays. The part that POLED plays in the evolution of OLED displays is that it is quite flexible. We have seen POLED displays before in devices other than the Google Pixel 2, a majority being from LG, with the most recent being in LG's LG V30 smartphone. The first wave of OLED panels were built using glass substrates, but the desire for more interesting form factors has seen this layer move over to use more flexible plastic components. While glass is fixed and rigid, plastic substances can be more easily formed into new shapes, even if the end result doesn't end up being highly flexible. Not to mention that working with plastics is much more cost effective than molding glass. Plastic OLED does have its own benefits over the glass variant that we're more familiar with. Perhaps the biggest is durability. The slightly flexible nature of the display offers some additional shock absorbance over glass, which means a slightly smaller chance of cracking your panel if you happen to drop your phone, and a longer lifetime from stress fractures. Plastic OLED is also up to as half as thin as glass OLED. This enables manufacturers to build slightly thinner devices, and we all know how much of a premium is placed on freeing up space in today's smartphones. Now, I'm gonna get a bit technical right here, but it's all worth it to get a better understanding of what POLED is. A range of plastics have been used, tried and tested for flexible displays, including polyethylene, terephthalate or PET, and polyethylene naphthalate or PEN. And again, I'm not a scientist, so I may have pronounced a few of those words incorrectly. However, the switch from a glass substrate also has to communicate the type of TFT technologies used in order to bring down the manufacturing temperatures or use of plastics that can withstand higher temperatures. As a result, flexible OLED manufacturers are using polyimide plastics or PI that can better withstand high TFT manufacturing temperatures. The type of substrate and heating process used also defines the flexibility of the display. Now, this is not a science channel, so I'm not going to be going all the way in depth with this, mainly because there is a good bit to understand. But if you understand what I have said so far, hopefully you already have a good bit of an understanding when it comes to POLED. So here are a few key things to keep in mind before we move on to IPS displays. Plastic substrate is thin and light. Plastic substrate offers better shock absorption and a less risk of breakage. Excellent viewing angles, a potential for a very wide color gamut, deep blacks and excellent contrast ratio, as individual pixels can be turned off, making it well suited for HDR. While POLED displays may not necessarily be the brightest, they still have the potential to become the commonly used displays in smartphones if things are done right. Now moving on to IPS. First off, I should state that IPS is actually nothing new. In fact, this technology was originally invented in 1996 by Hitachi. IPS is actually an LCD display that replaces the older TN panel that was commonly used. IPS is used for controlling the crystal elements that make up a display's RGB sub-pixel layout. IPS replaced twisted pneumatic field effect, or TN, as the technology of choice for LCD since the 90s, and is what you'll find in all LCD-based smartphone panels. Many of you already know the term LCD simply stands for liquid crystal display. It simply refers to thin display types that use unlit liquid crystals to formulate the display. It is important that you remember standard liquid crystals are unlit, because this means that they require some form of backlight in order to be visible. Think of your PC monitor, for example, or any monitor that uses an LCD display. If you would open it up and look inside of it, you would find that there are most likely two lights deep inside of the monitor setup that allow what is being displayed to be seen. If those lights burn out, then the chance of you really seeing anything is very low. But enough with that. We're getting back into smartphone displays. As I stated earlier, the iPhone 8 uses an IPS display as well as many other Apple devices. If you have been paying attention, you would realize that Apple has been pushing this display type in the devices for a really long time. Now onto how the IPS LCD really works. A polarized backlight passes through the liquid crystals in the display in front of the red, green and blue color filters for each sub-pixel. With IPS, a current is used to create an electric field parallel to the plate which twists the polarized crystal, which further shifts the polarity of the light. This then arrives at a second polarizer, which filters out the light based on its polarity. The more light that passes through the second polarizer, the brighter the associated RGB subpixel will be. Therefore, we can say that the brighter the light, the brighter the display, and that by itself is extremely obvious. Using different TFT or thin film transistor materials and production techniques can alter the driving properties of the display and alter the transistor sizes, which affects properties such as brightness, viewing angles and color gamut. Hence why you'll find a variety of different naming schemes for IPS LCD displays, including Super IPS, Super LCD 5, Advanced Super IPS, Horizontal IPS and many more. Now finally, a few points to remember about IPS. Good energy efficiency and battery life, excellent natural color reproduction and accuracy, no risk of burning, and well-refined manufacturing techniques, making LCD cost effective. For both IPS and POLED, we can see that display quality is a big focus, but although there are many good things about these displays, they still have their flaws, so you should keep this in mind. And that's about it for today's video. If you enjoyed the video, learned anything new, or want more content like this, feel free to subscribe for new videos every single week, hit the like button and comment your thoughts down below. Also, if you are inclined to, I would appreciate if you check out this channel on Patreon and become a patron to help out with the progress of this channel in terms of video quality. But that's about it for today. I hope you enjoyed this video and I will be seeing you in the next.